way I can decide whether to do something or not is to play the mental model in my head of, if it succeeds, will it have had enough impact on the world that giving up something I'll never get back, the time it took to do it, was worth whatever that impact will be if it succeeds. In a free culture where you get what you celebrate, you have to celebrate people that had the bold vision, put it all together, and then delivered a better world. Some of these young kids, 30 or 40 years from today, will have, for instance, won a Nobel Prize. Major breakthroughs that will change the way the future looks will happen as a result of what they did. And I will be able to say, I was part of that.
Watch your backs, golf cart coming through. Heads up, golf cart. Watch your backs.
My name is Emma Harland, and I have been part of FIRST since I was 8 years old. FIRST is all about growing your mind in both STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, as well as being a better person. When people don't know what FIRST is all about, and they're like, oh, you're a geek, you get to build robots, that's so nerdy. I come back to them and I'm like, yeah.
We started FIRST when I saw a need to help a whole generation of kids find something important to do. I set this thing up to be a cultural change agent. I wanted FIRST to change the culture of the United States. The invention of FIRST is to package science and technology to be more appealing and more exciting to kids than bounce, 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 throw. There aren't that many jobs for people that do that, but there are career opportunities for millions of people, not only in companies that exist now, but companies that will exist because of these kids. In fact, companies and industries that don't even exist today will be created by these kids. I had this simple vision. We know how to do that. The roadmap's there. The NFL, the NBA, Hollywood, they've known how to capture the hearts and minds of kids and make them super passionate. Kids that have been cheated out of even going after these opportunities. I've been pushing FIRST for more than 22 years. Most people would look at the growth of it and say, this is phenomenal. But after 22 years, it certainly hasn't met its original goal.
1 million people, a big number. Not compared to 7 billion. Not when it's the million with the skill sets and the attitude to fix the world. It should be a much bigger number.
My name is Dave Lavery. I'm the program executive for solar system exploration at NASA headquarters in Washington. I grew up during the 60s in the Apollo era, and the Apollo program was the inspiration that I looked to. Very close to 20 years ago, I was actually running the robotics research program of the agency. Every year, people would come in from the NASA labs and make proposals for the work they wanted to do next year. And I kept noticing it was the same faces over and over and over again, and they were getting a little bit older and a little bit grayer, and there was nobody behind them to be the next generation of robotics experts. Almost by accident, three kids in my neighborhood happened to see this little tiny, very quick piece on an evening television about the FIRST competition. They came down the street the next day, talked to me and my neighbors, and said, you guys make robots for NASA. We saw this thing about this robot competition. Would you help us? As soon as we got involved, we realized this was the next generation of robotics engineers that we were looking for. Very soon after that, we realized it wasn't really about just a couple of robotics engineers, but it really is all about the mentoring relationship that gets set up between the engineers and the students.
I've become a better person through FIRST. We do whatever it takes, even going out of our way to allow another team to be able to compete. This year in the Orlando Regional, two teams had been in a car accident the night right before the regional, and we completely rebuilt their robots. That is why one team is here today. They won that regional.
Even in the first year, when the competition wasn't this tough, I was already worried. I love the sports model because it gets to billions.
But there are things about some sports and the way people play them that don't make me proud.
The science community tend to come from a fairly unique perspective, and is one that personally I wish actually could be shared across the board. A lot of NASA's activities, for example, when I was younger and was growing up, very definitely were politically motivated by the effects of the Cold War, and it was certainly a very strong competitive aspect to what we were doing in the race to the moon. At the same time that was happening, within the science community, the planetary and the space science community, on both sides of the Iron Curtain, we recognized that there was a bigger goal there, that we really wanted to try to learn about space and the universe and our place within it. What did your space satellite just learn? What did we just learn? And can we increase our global knowledge as a result of both of our activities? Whenever we get hyper-competitive, I tend to think back to that and realize, yeah, I may be competing with these folks right now over this topic, but we may become very close collaborators. These kids are learning that right now, and they're going to be the generation who are going to take that whole philosophy forward and really, I hope, make it a true societal value.
I thought, right after the first season worked so well with every team that played, that, okay, it will now sweep through the country because it's a critical problem. It's a problem that's got to be solved. The mentors loved it, the parents loved it, the kids loved it. I figured, that's what I did with my summer vacation. We created this institution that will change the culture of the country. Now I can go back to some of my other problems. I really thought that. By the fifth year of FIRST, pretty much all the Fortune 500 were adopting schools. But you have to be a Fortune 500 company to be able to afford to take kids and parents and teachers and put them in airplanes and fly them to the one event. Kids can all be made to be excited by the Super Bowl about football or the World Series about baseball. But if the only way they could actually try it was to have a professional athlete fly them to a place, put them in a hotel, it's not scalable. Unless they can go out in the neighborhood and play Little League, we're toast.
David O'Neill, Harrison High School, sophomore. Shout out to the Hackbots.
We have lots of fun along the way, lots of things that go wrong in the best ways possible, yet we know how to fix them.
Hackbots three. Hack.
One, two, three.
Hackbots!
My name is Maddie Hacker. It is my first time in FIRST Robotics, and I'm here as the president-elect of ASME. What I've seen in my lifetime that made me the eternal optimist is actually the interest of people to provide solutions, the interest of young people to contribute and make a difference. My generation, when we were growing up, we were looking for a profession because it was respected in society. We could make a good living out of it. But today, you speak to the young people, they want to make a difference. When I come to an event like this, you cannot not have hope in the future when you look at the multiculturalism, when you look at the collaborative efforts between the team. So that encourages me a lot, much more than the technology.
Hey, FRC, currently time is 7 p.m. If you can hear my voice.
And I am a FIRST student. I'm captain of FRC team, FIRST Robotics Competition, and I'm also an actor. I have so much in common with my teammates and my mentors, but in the end, I think it's the building, the actual, I can do this. Like, here's a challenge, and I can build it. That's what keeps me coming back. I find that the most successful people in a science or technology field, they know what is already known very well, but they think about what isn't already known.
I'm Ben Sensen. I'm from Madison, Wisconsin. First and foremost, a family man. My first occupational passion was teaching. If we approach education the wrong way, we teach kids these protocols for getting known solution from a known starting point. You know, the canned lab. Kids these days don't value knowing things quite as deeply and personally as our generation did. You know, when I was growing up, if you were working on a project, you knew if you didn't trudge to that library and get the book, if somebody didn't already check it out, you were in deep doo-doo. You know, this generation is like, I'll just Wikipedia it, I'll download it, it'll archive. They don't value knowing the trivia. They value having the access path. So what we have to celebrate is the interaction. We have to celebrate the power of curiosity. if we really do think, oh my God, you guys live in a generation where you can look up and find anything, and you can see these beautiful relationships that other people have drawn from information. If that's really where we draw the line in the sand, then it implies that we're done with the world, and that really all you gotta do is find what other people have done. And I think it goes exactly the other way if you do it right. If you get kids to recognize the power of the knowledge and skills that other people have put out there for you, and then you embrace that with a confidence that you can interact with it in a meaningful way and come up with something new and unique, that's incredibly powerful.
My name is Woody Flowers. That's really my name. I am Popper Lauder Professor Emeritus at MIT. I grew up in a small town in Louisiana, literally dirt poor family. Got a chance to go to college because I have a crooked left arm, so I got a rehabilitation scholarship. Well, I've always been surrounded by people that are much brighter than me, and that's helped. In FIRST, the robots are all natural. Mother Nature applies all of her rules all the time. So when you build something and Mother Nature inspects it and says, nuh-uh, you get slapped on the hand, that's tough feedback. If they do a good job of that and they make it work, then they're not gonna have self-esteem because some adult told them they should. They're gonna reflect and say, yeah, I did that. Mother Nature, self, team, society, if you check those boxes in your own head, I believe you're in a much better place to say, I have rational self-esteem, and I think I can go tackle tough problems.
A student that we worked with many years ago was at the time a gang member who got involved with the robotics team and realized there's a different way that he had been just totally blind to before. He didn't even know it existed. And once someone showed him this is a possibility, he just took it and ran. Backed out of the gang life and focused on his robotics team, ended up taking them all the way to a national championship, and then for the first time anyone in his family ended up going to college and got a teaching degree. Those sort of stories are happening all over the place.
Even though that there are a lot of problems that can be solved by technology, sometimes it's better to do it yourself as a human. There's a reason we have feelings, there's a reason we have morals. And I think that it's important to keep those morals and those dreams, even as we pursue higher technology and a better world.
Every year, I think, this is the year that media will descend upon FIRST, and it will sweep through the country and become the primary activity that drives kids in their aspirational after-school life. This year, we handed out 29,000 kits to teams from 69 countries, 64 regionals. At the championship, we handed out $16 million in scholarships. We had 121,000 volunteer mentors. It's been 22 years, and still, FIRST is nowhere near the cultural change agent I hoped it would be. It's not available in every school, or even close. The average kid in this country, still, by the time they're 6, 7, 8, can tell you the name of a whole lot of famous people from Hollywood or the NBA. You still can't ask the average kid in this country, tell me the name of a single famous living scientist or engineer, and get anything but a blank stare. I get up every morning, I think, with the irrational exuberance and optimism about all my projects. At the end of the day, I always recognize how much further there is to go, how difficult this project's going to be, how many bumps we've already seen in this road, and the fact that the end of the road isn't even visible certainly is a reality to me. This is one of the clocks that I build as a trophy. The FIRST teams that win the big awards, that really get it, the trophies are clocks. And since I make the kids spend a lot of time making stuff, I figured the only fair way to make sure that they know we appreciate it is I make the trophy. And I want the winner each year to see time is moving. And we have to urgently grow. Because the world's in a race between all sorts of catastrophes and technical expertise, and whether it's environmental issues, healthcare issues, we can't let catastrophe win.